وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله الذي بنعمته تتم الصالحات جعل شهر رمضان موسما للطاعات وأفاض على الصائمين فيه من الخيرات وشرف أوقاته على سائر الأوقات والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد خير البريات وعلى آله وصحبه أولي الفضل والمكرمات والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الميعاد وبعد. My beloved brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to be starting a series in which we will be studying together and learning practical steps, educational points that we could benefit from our fasting in Ramadan. This series, inshallah ta'ala, the plan is to cover 30 points bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. These 30 points, each point inshallah ta'ala will be released at one particular night inshallah ta'ala for the entirety of the month of Ramadan. If the month becomes 29, then inshallah ta'ala two episodes will be released bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. The first, inshallah ta'ala, segment or the first episode today is going to be about, or it's going to be titled, Ahlan wa Sahlan. Welcome Ramadan. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as is authentically being transmitted from him, that he used to greet his companions. And he used to say to them, قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ شَهْرُ رَمَضَانِ شَهْرُ الْمُبَارَكِ. Verily, the month of Ramadan has come to you, a blessed month. And Ibn Rajab rahimahullah, he took from this rahimahullah, and he said that great scholars before him have already said regarding this hadith, that this hadith indicates and shows the permissibility of greeting one another when it comes to Ramadan. And he said, هذا الحديث أصل في تهنئة الناس في بعضهم بعضا بشهر رمضان. That this hadith is an evidence to show and indicate that the people can greet one another regarding the month of Ramadan. And why would that not be the case when Ramadan is a month of forgiveness, a month of expiation, a month where the doors of Jannah are open and the doors of the hellfire are closed. A month of righteous deeds, recitation of the Qur'an, a month of virtue. Why would it not be a month that people not greet one another? People greet each other for less than that. This month, my beloved brothers and sisters, is making its way to us. Recently, we were greeting Ramadan. And subhanAllah, here we're now greeting the next Ramadan. And this really shows us how fast our life is going. If you look at the early generation, the pious predecessors, rahimahumullah, they used to look forward to Ramadan. And they understood its virtue and its value. ولذلك, المعلى بن فضل, he said, كان السلف يدعون الله ستة أشهر أن يبلغهم رمضان. He said that the pious predecessors, the Sahabas and the Tabi'een and the Tabi'u Tabi'een, they used to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They used to beg Allah tabarak wa ta'ala أن يبلغهم رمضان. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows them to reach the month of Ramadan. And whenever they reached Ramadan and they fulfilled the days of Ramadan, they would cry to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala an yataqabbala minhum. They would cry to him and they would beg him and supplicate and invoke onto him subhanahu wa ta'ala an yataqabbala minhum, that he accepts it from them. So 6 months The Sahabas and Tabi'een and the Tabi'u Tabi'een, Salafus Salih, the pious predecessors, for 6 months they will be begging Allah Ta'ala to allow them to reach Ramadan. And once they fasted, they would be begging Allah Ta'ala until Ramadan comes again, and يَتَقَبَّلَ مِنْهُمْ, that He accepts it from them. This shows you that the preparation of Ramadan and the thought of Ramadan was always on their mind. Abu Bakr al-Shibli rahimahullah, it was said, إِذَا دَخَلَ شَهْرُ رَمَضَانِ, if the month of Ramadan entered, جَدَّ فَوْقَ جَدِّي مَنْ عَاصَرَهُ وَيَقُولُ شَهْرٌ عَظَّمَهُ رَبِّي فَأَنَا أَوَّلُ مَنْ يُعَظِّمُهُ. Abu Bakr al-Shibli rahimahullah, it was said about him, if the month of Ramadan entered, he would exert effort and hard work more than the people of his time. And he would say, شَهْرٌ عَظَّمَهُ اللَّهِ, it's a month, عَظَّمَهُ رَبِّي, my Lord has glorified it and venerated it. فَأَنَا أَوَّلُ مَنْ يُعَظِّمُهُ, I'm going to be from the first people who honor it and venerate it. يَحْيَى بْنُ أَبِي كَثِيرٍ, another great imam, it was said that he used to supplicate and he used to make dua, and he would say, اللهم سلمني إلى رمضان وسلم رمضان أما وسلم لي رمضان وتسلمه مني متقبلا. He will say, oh Allah, bring Ramadan my way, allow Ramadan to come to me, and oh Allah, allow me to come to Ramadan or to go to Ramadan, and oh Allah, allow me to benefit from that month, and in order to get from it acceptance. So they had this in their mind, Ramadan, and how they want to benefit from it. It was said that a slave girl, great scholars have mentioned the story, that there was a slave girl, and her master, he passed her on, and he sold her off to another master. She moved to the other household, and when she moved to the other household, she saw them one day preparing for Ramadan, getting food ready and everything. She said, what are you guys doing? This is the new household that she's in. She said, what is it that you guys are doing? And they said to her, we are preparing for Ramadan. And then she said, this is all for Ramadan. He said to her, yes. She said, wallahi, I don't want to remain a moment with you guys. I want to leave. And I want to go back to the household of my previous master. For verily, Ramadan was every day of the year for them. And they were fasting the whole entire year. It was like Ramadan for them. The way their ibadah was, and the way their fasting was, and the way their righteous deeds were. Until they returned her back to her master, a previous master, she didn't let them keep her. Again, this shows you how the Salafus Salih, the pious predecessors, were when it came to Ramadan. Ibn Majah and Al-Imam Ahmad also narrated in his Musnad that Talha ibn Ubaidillah, he had a dream. And in this dream, he saw something. But prior, before I mention the dream, there were two companions who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Both of them, they took Islam the same time. But one of the two men worked very hard. And he worked hard in the religion. Until a battle came and he participated in that battle and he martyred in that battle. Yani he became a shaheed in that battle. One of them. And then the other one, he died a year later. And he died in his bed. He didn't die as a martyr. And he wasn't as hardworking as the other one. Talha had a dream, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And in the dream, what he saw was that the one who died late, and he died 1 year later, and he died in his bed, had actually entered Jannah before the one who was a martyr, the shaheed. He entered Jannah before him. The shaheed who was working hard. The one who died a year later, who died in his bed, went into Jannah before him. So this to Talha was shocking. So he told the companions about what he saw. And the news reached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the news reached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said to Talha, "What is it that's fascinating you from this story? Or from the dream that you saw? What is it that's fascinating from it?" He said, "Ya Rasulullah, what's fascinating is that this man, he wasn't as hardworking as this man. And the one that was, who exerted less effort and didn't even die as a martyr, entered Jannah before the one who martyred." The Prophet then said to Talha, "Did he not live a year longer than the other?" Yani, did the one who entered Jannah first, did he not live a year longer than the other one? He said, "Yes." He said, "Within that year, did he not fast? Did he not get extra prayers and extra fasting?" He said, "Yes." And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Between the two of them is greater than the sama' and the ard." Yani, the distance between these two men is more than the sama' and the ard. Ponder here and think over this point. The Prophet stated two deeds that this man surpassed the other one with: salah and fasting. Yani, he got a Ramadan that the other one didn't get. The people who died last year and didn't get them Ramadan for this year are losing out and are wishing that they could get this Ramadan. Allah has favored you, my beloved brother and sister. Allah has given you that opportunity, inshallah ta'ala, to reach this Ramadan. You need to see it as a benefit. And you need to understand the value of what's coming your way. The question here is, how could I benefit from Ramadan? First of all, what you have to do is, you need to repent. You need to repent from every mistake that you did. You need to come with at-tawbah, repentance. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said in the Qur'an, وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا أَيُّهَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Repent to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, all of you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. Verily you're going to receive success and prosperity. By repenting, you will receive prosperity and success. Let me read on you a statement by two great imams. Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah, he said, Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, فَإِذَا تَابَ أَيِّ الْقَلْبِ, if the heart repents, and he turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ, from the sins, تَخَلَّصَتْ قُوَّةُ الْقَلْبِ وَإِرَادَتُهُ لِلْأَعْمَالِ الصَّالِحَةِ. The heart becomes strong and it becomes prepared and ready, and it becomes willing to do righteous actions. Yeah, and if you repent from something you've done, you repent from your sins, and you ask Allah for forgiveness, your heart will become strong, it will be ready, it will be willing to do righteous deeds. وَاسْتَرَاحَ الْقَلْبُ مِنْ تِلْكَ الْحَوَادِثِ الْفَاسِدَةِ الَّتِي كَانَتْ. And even your heart will find tranquility from the hardship and the calamities of sins and the corruption. Your heart will find tranquility because you repented. The heart is in a state of distress when sins are done on it. The minute you repent, the heart finds ease and starts to breathe. Your heart will start to thank you. Your heart will be ready. For what? It will be ready to do righteous actions because its eyesight comes back. The drive and the motive comes back. Ibn al-Qayyim, who is a student of Ibn Taymiyyah, he also said something similar to Ibn Taymiyyah. He said, فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ التَّوْبَةَ, if you've made the conviction, the unwavering conviction of repentance, وَصَحَّتْ, and it becomes a correct repentance, وَنَشَّأَتْ مِنْ صَمِيمِ الْقَلْبِ, and it gushes from the core of your heart. Yani, that repentance comes from the core of your heart. أَحْرَقَتْ مَا مَرَّتْ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ, it will burn all of the sins that it goes by. كَأَنَّهَا حَتَّى كَأَنَّهَا لَمْ تَكُنْ, like it was never ever there before. فَإِنَّ التَّائِبَ مِنَ الذَّنْبِ كَمَنْ لَا ذَنْبَ لَهُ, because the one who repents from a sin is like he's never done in his life. Ibn al-Qayyim is saying to you, if you make the decision, that conviction to repent, and it becomes a repentance which is sahih, you do it correctly, you come with these conditions, and that repentance really comes from the core of your heart, and you do it for Allah's sake, and you do it with the conditions, guess what, my beloved brothers and sisters? It will burn all of the sins that you've ever done, so much so that it will become like you've never done a sin in your life. And this is something to really understand. I want each and every one of us, bi-ijnillahi al-kareem, to start this month of Ramadan and to welcome it and to greet it with repentance. So that we, inshallah ta'ala, when it comes, our hearts and our mind and our body is ready for what's to come, inshallah ta'ala. That's for today's episode, bi-ijnillahi al-kareem. Anything I might have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Assalamu alaikum. If you're enjoying these videos and you'd like to keep up to date with all of the courses we're going to be running, make sure you head over to amauathome.com.